It's March 21, 2024. I'm at the World Health Organization at a negotiation on a pandemic treaty, and I'm here with Dimitri. Dimitri, can you start by introducing yourself, telling people who you are, who you represent, why you came to Geneva, how things are going in this negotiation, and what advice you have to negotiators?
Yeah, sure. So my name is Dimitri Eynikel, and I work for Doctors Without Borders, Médecins Sans Frontières. We're here at the World Health Organization, where indeed there's now negotiations for an international pandemic treaty. It's interesting because it's almost day to day, 4 years ago, that from this particular building here, COVID-19 was declared an international pandemic, the most recent one in our history. That killed many people worldwide, unfortunately. And after the pandemic, there have been major reflections about how to better respond to pandemics, how to better prepare, prevent pandemics, and then how to respond to that. There have been major disagreements about the response to the pandemic, and particularly a lot of low and middle income countries have felt left out in terms of getting support and access to the medical tools that they need to answer the COVID-19 pandemic. And that's a large part of the discussion here at the World Health Organization today. Countries, governments, member states are discussing collectively and in consensus how they will better respond next time and to create rules for themselves to how they will respond, how they will prevent them. From our side, we're particularly concerned about a number of issues. One is to make sure that healthcare workers, facilities, etc., are protected. That people can operate, provide medical assistance to those that need it in every country worldwide, and that the rules that exist already around this are incorporated in that agreement. Secondly, we are particularly concerned about the access to the medical tools. In the past COVID-19 pandemic, we've seen that countries that have the best access to these tools are the countries that were in the region where these tools were also produced. That a lot of the tools were also stayed in that region and were not distributed evenly around the world. So how to do that better? There's a couple of ways to do that. One is to set aside some of the doses that you purchase for a vaccine or a treatment and make it available for the global response to make sure that those who are most vulnerable, healthcare workers, people with certain health backgrounds, etc., get priority access to these products. The second way to do that is to make sure that the production is more distributed more evenly, that we have more supply from the start of, let's say, the outbreak or the response to potential outbreak, that at the same time in different regions, in different countries around the world, similar products are produced, and so we have better access to these products whenever it's needed. And on that approach, there's quite a bit of discussion on how to do that. Do you share technology? How are you going to deal with intellectual property rights, etc.? The negotiations are advancing, but it seems to be a difficult process because there's major different points of how to better respond to pandemics, but also how to prevent them, etc. There are expectations from different parts of the world towards each other how to deal with this. And that's a complicated exercise. But we're obviously hopeful for a good treaty or document, whatever the name will be, that will really have the buy-in and the commitment of all countries around the world to have a good standard response being ready for the next pandemic.
Is there anything that's happened this week that has surprised you?
I have to say the openness from the negotiators to speak with us. You know, there's really a lot of openness to speak with the people here at World Health Organization, including ourselves, and that has been a very positive surprise. We hopefully, or we count on the negotiators as well to see that reflected in their considerations at the meeting room, and that they don't stick with, you know, what we could be their own national concerns. We've seen with the COVID-19 pandemic, you need to supersede your own national domestic concerns in order to have an effective response. You know, the quicker you get out of a pandemic is if you collaborate with others and, you know, help each other out in terms of reducing cases, reducing mortality, and go back to normal life as quickly as possible. That's what everybody wants in the room, and that should be the basis to start from. And I have to say that you know, the openness to discuss, you know, points that we bring to the table is quite nice. There's quite a lot of openness. But that means, as I said, that you need to supersede your own particular interest as well.
Thank you very much.